AM 1050 WLIP. Welcome in Saturday morning and a brand new program that we are launching today. For those of you, I'm Pete, those of you who have followed my weight loss journey over the past several years know it is thanks to my connections with WLMD and wellness. And so we're going to talk about the truth about weight loss, not just the truths I had to learn, but the ones that you're probably not going to hear a lot of other places. And the founder and chief health strategist from WLMD and wellness is Sherry Stokas. Sherry, good morning. Happy Saturday. How are you?
Good morning. I am doing very well. Thank you. Excited to dig into this topic for sure.
Yeah, very good. We're going to talk about strategic weight loss today. But for those who are not so familiar, maybe they heard about WLMD and wellness. They've heard about my weight loss journey. But let's start in a little bit talking about WLMD and why you started the clinic and your passion for helping people not just lose weight, but for their overall health.
Yes, absolutely. So when I decided that I was going to, you know, take the plunge and go out on my own and really, you know, help people lose weight, I mean, that's obviously what the focus is. But, you know, I've said it over the years so many times, I knew that it was so much more than just putting people and meal plans, you know, reducing their calories, telling them to exercise more. I knew that there was more to the story. So that's why, you know, we are very unique in how we approach weight loss. Weight loss is multifactorial, and the body is in a different state of health, and you have to align with where people are at, because if somebody is you know, metabolically unhealthy, it's a much different approach than somebody who's healthy. So it really is about looking deeper when we have to look deeper and being more strategic about it.
I mean, there's so many launching points here when we talk about the truth about weight loss. And we could probably start with just in my own journey, the misconceptions I had about what it took to lose weight, but the misconceptions I had about what it meant to eat healthy, because I just thought it was, well, you have a vegetable with dinner, but it's more than just veggie as a side dish. It's a more, like you're saying, strategic approach, but it's a more whole approach. It's not going to be just one portion of your dinner. It's going to be all of your meals throughout the day.
Well, exactly. And, you know, eating, you know, there's so many different eating plans out there, right? We hear, oh, the keto, we have the paleo, the vegetarian. I mean, there's so many ways to incorporate healthy eating. And the one way is not going to work for someone long term. I mean, food is absolutely the foundation. And, you know, it's not only about the food you're eating, it's about how frequently you're eating. And what it comes down to is that everyone is different. So you know, for using you as an example, you were doing intermittent fasting. While that worked for you, that's not going to work for everybody. So it really is about finding, you know, that appropriate eating plan for you. And foundationally, we really have to start getting and moving toward eating whole foods. You know, 70% of the food that we eat today is processed chemicals. And so as you can imagine, if you simply just stop eating chemicals and start eating real whole foods, that's going to change a lot of things in your body. So yeah, it's, you know, sometimes it does take really going back to some of those basics.
Boy, you open a complete can of worms, or maybe I should say a can of processed slop when talking about the processed chemicals. But I want to go back to a conversation I had, what ended up being fairly early on in my journey. But I had a lot of initial success. And then we got to almost this time. It was actually late May. I had gone on vacation in 2019, and I was having dinner with a couple of friends. And we were talking about the weight I had lost up to that point. And my one friend asked me, he said, well, isn't it just calories in, calories out, right? You know, eating and then, you know, maybe doing more exercise or that kind of thing. Isn't it just that easy? And I said, well, no. And I was still very new to it, so I don't know if I explained it very well, but it definitely is more than just restricting calories and increasing exercise. That might work for you in the short term, but it's not for the long-term success, right?
I mean, exactly. I mean, this is a concept. This is something that we've been told forever. And this continues to be information that is put out there, that it's about the energy balance. It's about the calories that you're consuming versus the calories that you're expending. And the body is a little bit more sophisticated than that, right? Because there's so many things that drive balance in the body. And, you know, the body is always trying to protect itself. So if you're going to be someone who, you know, restricts, you know, the body is going to go into that mechanism of protecting you. So it's going to actually move you into more of a energy storing kind of mode versus, you know, helping you continuously lose weight. So, you really have to take a step back. Like some of those things, you know, eating the right amount of calories or restricting a little bit is going to help you maintain, say if you lost a little bit of weight and now you're trying to maintain. But this notion of restriction is so short term. And it's short term because people can only restrict for so long. But you actually do more harm in the process. I mean, you know, it's a hard thing to explain because when you think about it, it would seem to make sense when you lower your calories, right? So you lower your calories and you start to see maybe some, you know, some weight loss within like the week because the body is, you know, burning the calories that you're consuming. And then it has a choice. How am I going to get calories if there's not enough coming in from food? Well, then the body's going to go, oh, okay, well, I have some muscle, I have some fat stores. And so it will use a little bit of both when you're in this calorie deprived state. But unfortunately, now what happens, because we have so much metabolic dysfunction, the body only uses, you know, one piece, we have only uses one component of the fat stores and leaves the other. That's another whole complicated thing that maybe we can dig into, but it's really important to understand that unfortunately now the body isn't smart enough to just continue to use, you know, these fat stores to get you into that healthier place. So again, it kind of goes back to just being strategic and knowing how to do it. I know that was super long-winded.
That's okay. That's why it's truth about weight loss. We've got a little bit of a longer format here on AM 1050 WLIP. She's Sherry. I'm Pete. It's our new Saturday morning show. Sherry from Wayless MD and Wellness. What I came to realize, Sherry, talking about how our bodies deal with calorie restriction and increased physical activity, is it's a misunderstanding of how our bodies came to function the way they do. Because being settled down, growing our own food, it being readily available, let alone being able to go to the fast food restaurant basically on demand or people, it gets delivered to you in 10 minutes or less, all of that is so modern. And our systems were already set in stone with how they work well before we invented any of these things, even if it's 10,000 years ago. So when your body, the way it used to be in, say, in a hunter-gatherer type thing, is your body stored the fat when it had the food and had the fat. And then you would go without eating for a while, and it would go into what you were saying is that calorie restriction mode and using the fat stores. So we are way out of whack with our systems and how we deal with food and nourishment and nutrition in the modern times. And our system doesn't match the technology, if that makes any sense.
Oh my gosh. I mean, that's exactly it. When you think back, like from an evolutionary standpoint, you know, that's exactly it. Like, you know, humans went periods of time without food. So when you restrict your body, we still genetically are made that way. And so our body does sense that, you know, food is not coming in. So everything, you go into more of that, you know, energy storing mode. And, you know, again, like you're exactly right, because genetically nothing has changed from a environment lifestyle place. It has changed so much. There's nothing that aligns with who we are as humans and how we were developed, you know, hundreds and whatever, thousands of years ago. So it's just, it's the misalignment is causing, you know, again, this, our body's ability to not be able to withstand, you know, the place that, the environment that we live in any longer.
I know we want to talk about the different factors that go into weight loss. Genetics is one of them. And, you know, we kind of touched on environment there, but it's not just with our food. We're so out of sync with everything, the way our body was created to work. I mean, with sleep, for a long time, if you didn't have electric light, you know, artificial light, you slept at sundown. You maybe were up for a few hours, and then you went back to sleep, and you had this dark window of time to sleep in. And now we have our screens, we have our computers, we work third shift. I mean, we are just so out of whack in our modern society. I know this sounds like I'm preaching we should be Amish and go like back to an earlier age, but you know what I mean? Like, our bodies really don't know how to cope with a lot of this, and therefore we don't know how to cope with it.
Well, exactly. I mean, sleep is so foundational, and so many people ignore the foundational, fundamental, you know, pieces to a healthy body and a healthy lifestyle. I mean, you know, we can't talk about sleep so much. It's like, you can try to go on all these diets, eat healthier, you know, do all these things to improve your health. But foundationally, if you are not getting the right amount of sleep, none of it literally matters. I mean, it's kind of like, when you sleep, it's like recharging your battery. It's when, you know, you regenerate, everything starts to rebalance in your body, your brain, you begin to create these, you know, neural pathways that are healing to the body. And when you don't have that, when that process is not happening, you're running on a low battery all of the time.
It's kind of like when your phone doesn't quite make the connection with the wireless charger.
Exactly.
You know,
exactly.
And so you're not getting that connection in there. Sherry Stoka, Wayless, MD and Wellness. Truth About Weight Loss, Saturday mornings here on WLIP. I jumped into sleep on there. It wasn't exactly, well, it was kind of down on the list with lifestyle a little bit. But it's right along, and I think people would just kind of understand this instinctively. Sleep, stress, emotional state, they're all kind of connected. So we talk more and more about mental health, kind of realizing the effect that that has on our overall health, but it has an effect on our weight and on the obesity epidemic as well.
I mean, exactly. And you know, I've been doing this for so long, and so many people want to just move past all of that. And they want to talk about, what type of diet can I go on to lose weight super quick? And that's all fine and dandy, but again, you're always going to be brought back to the foundation. And that's why we're always talking about that with people. You know, again, you know, what are the things that we can do to improve our sleep? How are you responding to stressful situations? It's incredible how so many people come in and they're just like, they're on overdrive. They don't even take a step back to like really realize, like, you know, and reflect on the life that they're living. It's like everyone's, you know, full speed ahead. And then there's the component of just your emotional state, the relationships in your life, you know, how you treat people. Do you approach the day in a positive way, or are you just, you wake up and you're already thinking about all the bad things in your life? Like, all of those things are absolutely crucial.
We have talked before, and I don't know if we've ever, I think we mentioned it in a podcast that you and I did together previously, but I don't think we ever talked about it on the air. It sort of reminds me of the old saying, when the student is ready, the teacher appears. And before I had started with Wayless MD and Wellness, before I ever thought about taking the weight off, I had started to focus on my own mental health, which at one point wasn't always in the greatest spot. I mean, you know what my schedule was even back then. It was quite stressful, and I found mindfulness meditation, and there's all sorts of different things that you can do, but I had actually read an article about it in a magazine and kind of intrigued me, and I did a little bit more research, and I started to practice, and wouldn't you know it, things got better. And then I think maybe even subconsciously, that was setting the table for the weight loss, because once I started taking care of my diet and my nutrition, I had the mental health, wellness sort of underlying all of that. So when that got difficult, like the not being able to snack or the not being able to eat the processed sugar, that type of thing got difficult, I sort of had the underlying things that that would help me get through that and would sort of help get over some of those hurdles.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. And it's truly about, maybe people hear this all the time, but I'm obviously so into, really that mental capacity and what you tell yourself and how you put yourself out there in the world. And, your behaviors are so driven by what you believe, right? And what you kind of say to yourself and put out there. And until you can gain control of that mental state and your belief systems, I mean, you will always stay in that stagnant state. It's like, usually when I'm talking to somebody and we're, ready to start this journey, the first question I want to ask is, do you believe you can do this? Because people come into these, these situations where they want to make so many changes, but in the back of their mind, they're saying to themselves, oh, this is just another, another diet, I'm going to fail. And that right there, you will fail. So it is really changing really your approach and how you see things.
And there's always a connection, again, I think a lot of people are aware of, between stress and eating. I mean, between other less than helpful behaviors, people get stressed and they smoke cigarettes or they eat junk food or whatever the case may be. So having a healthy channel, you're going to get stressed. Like, there's no way around these things. There's no magic bullet that says, now you're going to live on cloud nine and there'll be no rest. No, you wouldn't want to live like that anyway. That'd be a whole nother level of stress, right? But you need to have a healthy way to channel that. And so many ways, the negative way of channeling that takes a toll on the relationship with food.
Absolutely. I mean, it really is about digging deeper into yourself and getting to know the person that you truly are and the person that you want to be. And that I wish we could go there with people, because we can help people so much with some of the more tangible things. But at the end of the day, like you just said earlier, when they come to the table and they want help, like we can only do so much. It's really up to the person and where they're at and where they want to see themselves, because anyone can accomplish anything, right? And it's all about what they believe they can do.
Sherry Stoka is from Wayless MD and Wellness, Southport Plaza in Kenosha, waylessmd.com. I'm Pete. It's our new Saturday morning show, Truth About Weight Loss. We're doing a little bit of a deeper dive into some of the topics you have heard us talk about before on other platforms on the air. And Sherry, of course, has different webinars and seminars that she's done over the years, sort of diving into this information. But Sherry, there is such a lack of knowledge out there when it comes to what it takes to be healthy, what it takes to lose weight. And so we've really got ourselves in a polarizing conversation where you have people who do the diet culture thing, and they try one after another and varying levels of success, but no ultimate success. And then you sort of get the other side of the conversation, which says, obese and beautiful, baby, I'm just going to own it. And of course, you're going to own it for a very short lifespan because your body can't tolerate that. So I think that the reason why I'm excited to do this show is to try to cut through both of those extremes and say there's a way to be body positive, but there's a way to be healthy, and there's a way to be a healthy weight and still enjoy your life. All of these things play into a balance. And I wish there was a simple answer. You say, yep, it's like a math equation, do X, Y, and Z, and you get A, B, and C. But a balance is, there's a science to it, but there's an art to it as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I do just think we've gotten so far removed from the truth and really what we need to do, because really there are so many ways that you can incorporate healthy living and becoming, a healthier body. And ultimately, you have to dig deep into the more foundational things and kind of see where you're at, because it's not just about the weight. It's not just about how you look. It's about starting from ground zero and doing those foundational things. Again, cleaning up your diet, getting adequate sleep, surrounding yourself around people who make you feel good versus people that make you feel bad, and really being reasonable and realistic with where you truly feel is a good, not only, you know, just not only a good weight for you, but where you feel healthy, and starting from there. And if you, you know, if you feel good at a weight that is not within, you know, those BMI, you know, metrics, that is okay. You can be very healthy and feel beautiful and, you know, so many things that go along with just confidence and things along those lines. But it's about really digging deeper into that piece of it and where you want, you know, where you feel more comfortable, basically.
You don't have to be a bodybuilder to be metabolically healthy. You know, you can have, you can be an average looking person, like I think I am, and still be healthier and still care about these things, and not have to sort of give in to the extremes on either side, which is why I like the approach at Weight Less, MD and Wellness, because we've talked about it many times, but I think it bears repeating. You have the chart or the graphic of the two different body types, a similar BMI, but they don't look the same, but both being metabolically healthy.
Well, exactly. And the reverse can be as well. You know, you can be a low weight, but be extremely metabolically unhealthy, you know, based on the muscle and the fat ratios and things like that. So it definitely goes both ways. You know, we're fed this information that we need to look a certain way. And, you know, that has just caused so many different behaviors. It causes people to become more stressed because they're supposed to be this way. So then, you know, again, it's just the cycle of misinformation and misinterpretation out there.
It popped into my brain a conversation I had with somebody the other day. They had talked about, they work different events and working one recently, which brought them to a lot of different restaurants. And they says, well, after that week, I got on the scale and that was quite disappointing. You know, they had gained weight, and they says, and now I'm trying to calorie restrict, skip a meal, that kind of thing. And I said, you know, maybe just eat all your meals, but eat less at those meals, you know, do something a little bit more strategic than, well, I'm going to punish myself. And I really think that there is almost something subconsciously where there's this punishment to say I've been doing the wrong thing, and now I'm going to calorie restrict, and I'll show me, and then I'll get back into the track that I want to do. But again, it goes back to where we sort of started this conversation. Your body's smarter than that. You can't just restrict calories and punish yourself in the gym. It's not going to work.
Well, right. And it just goes along with that cycle that everybody, you know, that everybody perceives as normal, and diet being that very negative kind of connotation. Is a diet, you know, a diet is, people think that, you know, your life is over and, you know, you can't enjoy anything anymore because you're on this diet, when it really is at the end of the day about changing the way that we think about, I hate to say just weight loss, but the way we think about health and the way we think about eating, because we have to come to a place where you are enjoying food, you are not craving so many things because the body is out of balance, and you have something that is sustainable long-term. So it's not about self-sabotage. It's not about, okay, you went to a restaurant 3 times this week, easy, okay, not a big deal. Let's get back to what you normally do long term. It's, you know, and obviously we talk about this, but it really is about not thinking about the willpower and the diet and that mentality of weight loss and restriction. We just have to think differently about it.
She is Sherry Stoka, Weight Less, MD, and Wellness. I'm Pete. It's AM 1050 WLIP. Sherry, we're going to take our bottom of the hour break, and we're going to come back. We've got more truth about weight loss with Sherry Stoka from Weight Less, MD, and Wellness on AM 1050 WLIP. Saturday morning. morning, our brand new Saturday morning show. First episode today is Truth About Weight Loss with Sherry Stoka from WLIP MD and Wellness. I'm Pete. You probably heard me talk quite a bit about WLIP MD, and you know, my motto has always been WLIP for success. I lost over 100 pounds, Sherry, and it's been a life-changing thing. And even, you know, you hear that number when people lose a whole bunch of weight, it's very impressive. But I noticed the changes, and I started to feel better after taking 4 pounds off in the first week, I think. You know what I mean? And obviously it was 4 pounds there, another 3 there, 4 there. But over time, that sort of snowballs. And after a month, you really start to notice the improvement and the difference.
Oh my gosh, I know. It is because the body wants to feel good. The body wants to work optimally. And I say it all the time, like things can happen very, very quickly. And that's also, you know, in the world that we live in and the modern, you know, healthcare system, you know, we want to treat the symptom without digging deep into the foundational root issues. But if we just do the right things, if we clean up our diet, if we get adequate sleep, if we, you know, change our mindset, it is incredible how quickly the body responds to that.
First half hour of the show, we talked a lot about the things that we can control, whether it is stress management, getting more sleep, dealing with our emotional states. I want to talk a little bit about some of the things that are a little bit more difficult to control. And one of them you can't really control at all, short of like sitting on a microwave, which we don't encourage you to do. And that's your genetics. And I know sometimes this can play into sort of, well, I can't do it, it's glandular, or it's in my genetics just to be heavier. But all of that aside, I mean, there is an effect that your genes and your genetics has when it comes to trying to lose weight. This is something I learned firsthand, Sherry.
Yeah, exactly. So I think what's really important to understand is absolutely, we all are, you know, provided with this genetic makeup, you know, when we are put on this planet, when we, you know, when we are born to this, you know, to this life. And, you know, there's a lot of, again, misconceptions out there about genes. We cannot change the genes that we have, but what we know now is that genes are very much influenced by external forces, external factors, such as environment. So we call this epigenetics, right? So it's how the genes are being expressed based on your decisions and your behaviors and lifestyle. So if you were given, you know, genes that maybe, you know, put you at risk for certain cancers or weight loss resistance or, you know, whatever those genes predisposed you to, you can always express or change the way that they're going to impact your health. So if you are, you know, if you are someone that never exercises a day in your life, but you know, you have genes that really are like, oh, exercising is going to change your health span. You know, those are things that we have control over. So, you know, the number of people that come in and say, oh, you know, my mom had diabetes, my aunt had diabetes, my grandmother had diabetes, I'm just doomed. It absolutely is not true. You have control over your health, and genetics are just a very small piece to that.
I mean, if you think of genetics as like building blocks, all right, well, there might be a limitation with what you can build with building blocks, but on the other hand, you could build a tower, you could build, you know, more of a square building. There is the influence on the blocks themselves, and that's how your genetics work. So, you know, if you're predisposed to, unfortunately, like certain kinds of cancers, and you're going to smoke a pack of cigarettes a day, you're going to create an environment that's going to be very, very bad for you. Whereas if you're genetically predisposed, maybe it wouldn't affect you as bad. There'd be other complications, but we're talking about the genetic component of this. And so that's sort of where we can talk about the next thing on your list, and that's genetics and environment. Again, you can't necessarily control all the aspects of your environment, but you can help influence it as you can with your genes. And I would guess those two components go hand in hand.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, we have genetics that, you know, sets the stage for our body's ability to detoxify, our body's ability to lose weight, our body's ability to metabolize certain nutrients. I mean, there's, you know, there's it's a complicated system. But then there's, again, our decisions, the environment. If, say, you know, we live in an environment and that's where, like, the food, you know, 70% of the food that we're consuming is not food at all. It's actually just processed chemicals. And now if you're eating a diet that is high in processed food, and you live, say, in the city where there's, you know, a lot of, you know, pollutants in the air, or you live by an airport, or let's say you have air fresheners, you know, that are plugged in all around your house, you know, it's like the toxic pool and how you're surrounding yourself, combining that with your genetics, if they're not, you know, if they're not aligning, obviously your results are not going to be optimal. So you have those decisions to clean up the environment, you know, make those better choices. And it just going back to doing the right things most of the time and watching how your health responds.
Talking with Sherry Stoka, WLS MD and Wellness. She's the host. This is our brand new first edition, a Saturday morning show called Truth About Weight Loss. And Sherry, of course, from WLS MD and Wellness, the founder and chief strategist at WLS MD. You can check it out, WLSMD.com. Now, the next word and topic we're going to focus on, I think, is a very loaded one. And that's the word diet. Now, it might supposed to mean, Sherry, what you eat. But when we think of diet, it's a loaded word, because we think all of the other baggage, the calorie restriction, the not eating certain foods, the diet culture. So when we talk about diet, let's define our terms, and then let's talk about how it interplays with the environment and with the genetics.
Yeah, so diet to me is what our eating regimen is, what we're eating most days of the week. Whereas when we use the word diet, sometimes people, you know, most people will think restriction. Oh, I cannot ever have pizza a day in my life, or I can never go out to this restaurant or have my dessert. That's how people perceive the word diet. But for me, I'm looking at something that is, you know, part of your sustainable lifestyle. So it is foundational. There's so many different complexities to it because of how confusing it is out there and what we're told to eat. Like, again, all of these keto, do keto now keto's bad. Wait, what should I do intermittent fasting? Oh, I heard that, you know, so there is so much confusion. And then you, again, you know, tying it to diet with the type of foods, and then you have the processed nature of it, our genetics. So all of it comes together. And at the end of the day, we have to break this down and get back to some of the more simple, basic steps of improving, you know, lifestyle.
And that's really what it is. It's taking it a step at a time. And you're right about the missing. I remember the first time I heard about the keto diet, and I think it was at a party, and I was listening to this, like, and this is before, you know, I had started my own weight loss journey, and I go, this is nuts. People do this. Remember the Atkins diet was the big thing? I think that's still a brand name out there. Yeah. of things you can purchase, and, you know, whether or not that works. I think what leans into the confusion too is that some of these things will work, at least in the short term. But I know we even talk about it, like with semaglutide, the breathless headlines of, well, once you go off it, it doesn't work anymore, or you gain the weight back or whatever. I mean, you can do all of these tricky things to try to fool the system, as it were, but it comes down to the fundamentals, because you can only trick the system for so long.
Yeah, you really can. And you can drive yourself crazy in the process. You know, I think just always going back to what we were designed to consume as human beings is super important. We were designed to eat fruits and vegetables. We were designed to eat animal protein, not too much of it, but we were designed to eat that. You know, we were meant to eat off of the ground, you know, the planet Earth. And when you remove yourself further from what we were meant to do as humans, then you are just moving yourself closer to a disease state. So, you know, I can't emphasize enough how important it is to really, really think about that, reflect on that. Like if your diet is mainly, you know, colorful, you know, dyes, and, you know, you're looking at the label and there's a list of ingredients that you have no idea what it is, you know, it's just, it's kind of bringing people back to like, oh yeah, duh, like, why would I think this is healthy for me? You know, really just kind of thinking through where we were years ago, because our ancestors, you know, they were not eating how we're eating today.
No, and that goes back, I mean, mentioned it in the first hour of the show, just in the past probably maybe 20 years, but certainly 50 to 100, and then you go back into like deep time, and you're talking about a way of life that would be quite foreign and difficult to do for a lot of us, but that is the way that we were made, and that's the way our bodies sort of learned to function over time. And we're going to, before we wrap up this morning, give some practical tips on what we can do, short of like going and hopping in a DeLorean and becoming hunter-gatherers, you know, what you can do in your everyday life to try to get back in touch with this. Sherry Stoka, WLS MD and Wellness. And it does come down to making some conscious decisions, because once you know, and I think education is the first, at least it was for me, I had to know what to do. Then it's implementing it. And it you know, I have a cousin who's very health conscious. She's younger than I am. She's metabolically healthy, never was obese or anything. But when I would go through my weight loss journey, she would be very strict about what she would or wouldn't eat. And I would say, hey, you know, I had a scoop of ice cream and I still lost weight this past week. Hey, you know, I had a mini Snickers bar and I still lost. My point being not to tease her over, I can still eat. And it became a meme in our family. Like, I can still eat this and lose weight. But it's to say, look, you can have your fun and still be metabolically healthy. So again, it's sort of this balance between the way our bodies function, what we should do and what we can do, and still engaging with some of those other things so we're not feeling like we're deprived or we're punishing ourselves. And that comes back into the mental health aspect of it too, because it's very much like a scale, not just the one you weigh yourself on, but all of these different things in balance on all these different sides, Sherry.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think we have this mentality of it's all or nothing, right? We've removed ourselves from the balance that is so necessary. You know, when you find the balance in your eating habits and certain, you know, lifestyles that you're participating in or decisions that you're making, and it's solid, when you have that solid foundation, you are able to do and enjoy other things. But when you go back to that foundation, then it's fine. Nothing changes. It's just that we're approaching health, we're approaching weight loss with this all or nothing, basically perception. And that's what's keeping us in that cycle. And that's what's creating this idea of we must rely on willpower. We must restrict. We must be miserable while we lose weight. It should not be like that. There are so many people that eat healthy foods, they're healthy weight, they exercise every day, and they go out and maybe have too much at a meal, but they know the next day they just go back to their normal eating regimen. So that's really what, you know, ultimately where we want to see people go.
Talking about the emotional state with eating quite a bit, and again, this segment we're kind of focusing on some of the intangibles that you can influence, if not completely control. And again, another one of those is your hormones. And I think that's one of those things where it kind of gets blamed for a lot of the reasons why people don't have success. But I would imagine, just like when you're talking about environment and genetics, hormones are something that you can influence for the better, if not take total control of.
Yeah, you know, it goes back to foundational health. You know, if hormones are imbalanced, it's because the body is out of balance, right? So usually it's about, you know, looking at the most foundational piece of the human body, which is the gut. When the gut is compromised, that's going to affect the hormones. So, you know, even when we're, you know, we help people with balancing their hormones. I mean, we have a hormone specialist at WLS MD. But we don't, when people come in and say, oh, my hormones are all over, I have hot flashes, I have, you know, these cravings, I am tired all the time, we don't look at them and say, okay, we're going to balance your hormones, right? What we do is we try to get the body into a healthier state so that the body in itself will heal and rebalance the hormones. So it's a different approach. It's kind of like, you know, you go to see your doctor and you tell them that, you know, whatever, you go in with certain symptoms and you leave with a couple medications. That's not how you're supposed to approach things. Let's dig deeper. Let's fix the foundation so that the body responds and things start to heal and rebalance on its own.
Sherry Stoka, WLMD and Wellness. Believe it or not, we just have a handful of minutes left. I want to get to the practical application to a lot of this and ask the question, what fundamental things should we be doing every day to get us back on track when it comes to these different factors we've been talking about?
Yeah, so, I mean, again, I think we've said it 100,000 times in this
segment. It's worth repeating.
So we must get adequate sleep. It must be good quality. It must be at least 7 hours a night. If you're not getting the sleep, it's going to be really difficult to fix other areas. So that's really important. You know, reflecting on your stress levels. Are you somebody who is in a stress state all the time? If you are, really digging into that. How can you respond better to certain situations? And that really comes back to taking some time for yourself. Like, get out of the rat race. Start thinking, you know, spend some time, whether it be meditation, whether it be journaling, you know, get to know who you are and who you want to be. And that in itself you will start to see other things just happen when you really take a step back to reflect, you know, on really what you desire and who you are as a person. And then I would say the next thing is, it is obviously the diet. Just start eating real food. By simply eating real food most of the time, again, it's about doing those things so that other things start to respond. I would say those would be like the four kind of core things that you could start working on today.
I really want to think about the mental health aspects of it, or maybe just the mindset aspects of it, because one of the things I keep coming back to is things happen as they do. Whether it's positive or negative, or we, you know, it's our judgment on them, sits with us. And one of the sort of mantras I come back to is, not everything that happens demands an immediate judgment from me. Right? So I can, you know, something can happen and I can immediately judge that as the most terrible thing that can happen all day. But it is because I pin that title or that feat on it. If you can sort of trend more towards not making judgments, right, but just being a little bit more even keeled, not overreacting to things, especially, you know, when you're on the health journey, the weight loss journey, you're going to get some hiccups, some hurdles, whatever it is. Not overreacting to those things really keeps the stress level in balance. You're not the judge. Not everything demands an immediate negative judgment. You just kind of have to, I know it's going to be cliche, go with the flow a little bit. When you're in the flow of things, things tend to come together and work out.
Yeah, you know, that's another whole segment in itself. But really, what our thoughts are, you know, what we're telling ourselves will manifest in our life. So if we truly don't have control over our mental health, if we don't have control over the thoughts that are going through our, you know, through our mind, it will be really hard to create the health or create the life that you want. It really does come down to that mental piece. Absolutely.
Sherry Stoka, Wayless MD and Wellness at waylessmd.com. Last couple of minutes we have, I want to plug Wayless MD and Wellness a little bit, just because, I mean, it's changed my life so much. And, you know, if you've been listening to this and you go, yeah, but if that's your main reaction, I mean, I get it. I was, as you probably remember, Sherry, I was a little bit skeptical at the time, not only about the process, but about my ability to do it. So I get it if that's where you find yourself today. But WLMD and Wellness is really set up to take it one step at a time. You have the weight loss plans are customizable. You've got great support, great staff at WLSMD. And if you're, you know, get started and you do hit some of those hurdles that are inevitable, WLSMD and Wellness is there to help. And that's why I say WLS for success, because you're going to find that success over time if you stick with it.
Yeah, absolutely. It's not a cookie cutter approach. Obviously, we meet people at, you know, where they're at. And it really is, you know, sometimes people want something, a quick reset. Some people are like, you know what, like you were like we worked together early on. It was like, just let's focus on one or two things at a time. And then you start to see that snowball effect. So it really is about, you know, treating each individual as their own person and, you know, aligning with the journey that they're on.
So if people want to get to more information about WLSMD, well, you got the clinic, Southport Plaza in Kenosha, but you've got multiple locations now, and the website, WLSMD.com, would be the best starting place for all of that.
Yeah, absolutely. We have our Brookfield location. I franchised WLSMD last year, so we have a couple new locations, always looking to build, because we do, you know, I do feel like we have a very special, unique model that is not only going to help people obviously lose weight, but really change their health. And our website, yes, is a great place to start. Obviously, our phone number, anyone has any questions, they could give us a call at 262-226-2046.
Sherry Stoka, WLSMD and Wellness, you're the best. Have a great week. We've got one show under our belts already. And you know, it's a pretty good feeling, pretty good sense of accomplishment.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you so much.
Very good, Sherry. We will chat with you next Saturday morning. Have a great weekend. You're listening to AM 1050 WLIP.